Okay, we're good to go. So yeah, I've been busy in the last week, like applying to jobs, so I still didn't get to the opening stuff. But what we could do today is, I guess, talk about the Nydorf Sicilian, since that's kind of one thing I was asking about last time, since I might switch from E5 to back to something that, I guess, doesn't require as much strategic knowledge or positional play, and just more knowledge of concrete lines, which I guess I shouldn't have a problem like learning that might actually suit my learning style better.
Oh, that could be. But I mean, there are some lines where that will happen. I mean, Bishop G5, for example, is one very concrete line against an idol. But White can also try to play positional. I mean, don't think like when you play the Nydorf, you will be avoiding all that always, because it's not exactly like that.
Yeah, but I guess
Also,
like mm-hmm.
there's Bishop B5 check, which, I mean, if someone wants to play a boring positional game, they can still go Bishop B5 check. So those are some details to consider at least.
Yeah.
Okay, I will create a study. Ah, no, not the study. I will invite you on chess.com.
I think even with that, I guess more of the games would be something that's what I
Yes. That
prefer.
that's for
Necessary.
sure. That's for sure. It's like with E5, it's almost every game will be quiet position. Like with the Nydorf, you will have, let's say, 50-50 if you want, but at least it's gonna be more concrete sometimes. Okay, I'm creating it. Okay, I think it should be okay now.
Yeah, I got it.
So, yeah, we can talk a bit about the Nydorf in general, but at least what to study, what you should know. Like, I know if you want, we can start with that, if that's okay.
Yeah, and also if you have any book recommendations for that that I could look into. Like, I don't know if you still
Yes.
recommend like a repertoire book for that or.
Yes, for sure. I will send you a few. There is a lot of material for the Nydorf, but let me think which one would be nice. There's you don't have a chess base, right?
I got chess base.
Okay. Then even better than books, I have some databases. One is by Giri, that he covers everything for the Nydorf. I mean, it's very, very good work. And it's, I mean, maybe some line you don't like, that could happen. I mean, you don't have to like everything someone recommend, but it's a good guide. At least you will know which alternatives your opponent has as white, right?
I see.
That's what I wanted to show you without too many concrete lines today. So the Nydorf is d6, and well, basically it's a6 in move 6, right? But in move 5. But well, there's some anti-Sicilians that you should know. Of course, there is Alapin, there is close Sicilian, there is, I don't know, Grand Prix attack, all these type of things, Mora Gambit, Wing Gambit, all this. But the only anti-Sicilian I consider to be like really annoying is Bishop B5 check. I mean, this one is very decent for white. And did you have anything in mind? I mean, you have like three options here. You can block with the bishop or the knight on d7 or knight c6. Have you seen this position before? Or what do you decide if?
I think I used to just go Bishop D7.
Okay. Bishop d7 is probably the most solid one, but also leads to the type of position you are probably trying to avoid. Because usually, I mean, here you take with the knight or with the queen.
Think maybe I did the queen. It was like a long, long time ago, though.
Yeah, I mean, queen is the main move, 97 is also playable, but this type of position is quite boring, and I have the feeling that in general, after bishop b5 check, neither players will be playing 97. Why? Because you are playing the Nydorf to have a fighting game, right? You don't want to end up in some sort of, I mean, C3, D4 stuff, or even the Maloxi. That's very reasonable for white. I think C4 is the best move here for white, but also they do this a lot with C3. And here we really need to play this reaction, right? We can't allow him to keep pushing in the center. We need to fight for the center, and here knight e4. This is super theoretical. I don't know if you saw Carlsen losing against Duda. He went queen e2 here with the same idea, right? C3, d4, this d5 here, knight e4, and this is more or less even, but maybe not the type of concrete game you're looking for when you play the knight of. I have the feeling that usually dragon players tend to play bishop d7 for some reason, and neither of goes knight d7 more than bishop d7. I always play knight d7 here. I did knight c6 a few times, but the truth is I never won bishop d7 because I don't feel like playing this type of position, because it's too positional, too dry, you know, like. And white is probably looking for that type of game. So my first advice is, if you get to this position, study knight e7. Why this? Because, well, if he wants to take, you have the bishop pair. And if not, you will go a6, b5, and eventually you will play developing moves after d4 you will take. Usually when this happens, he can take with the queen, right? Because the knight's not coming to c6. But still, I prefer knight e7, and everything I will send you, it's going to be about this move probably. I believe it goes better with the neither type of play, I suppose. Then another sideline that is not so silly is c3. Again, white is trying to get some sort of Alapin, but they want to play d4 and keep the center, right? So we go for the pawn. We can't take it immediately, right? That's queen a4. So if they play h3, don't blunder the knight. Usually what we will do is maybe just c6, bishop c7, castle, and at some point white has to defend. There are some very concrete lines with knight c6 because they can go d4. The same after bishop e2, actually. Bishop e2, knight c6, they go d4. What happens now if we take e4?
Not sure. Well, I was looking at them taking on c5, but I don't think that does anything, or pushing d5. Then the knight just moves out the way. I'm guessing it's something else. The only other thing I would think about is just them castling. So I don't really see anything outside of those moves.
Well, there's a very concrete tactical thing here. If we take the pawn, immediately we blunder a piece because of d5, right? There is queen a4 if we move the knight. If we take first, this is much more complicated, and I don't understand exactly what's the right evaluation here. But if we take the pawn, and now we take after d5, of course, if we move the knight, the same happens. But now we have this intermediate move, right? Queen a5 check first. Covering a4, right? So, for example, if you would play knight e2, knight c3, king f1, moves like this, we could just move the knight and keep playing, right? Actually, knight c3 is the best move here, but if you do this, I can go knight e5. If you do bishop d2, I don't know, I can even take on d5 maybe. I can just take on d2 and move the knight. But ninety-three is super, super complicated because here the line continues 95. Actually, we can also play 93 here, 95. Or actually, we should play 95 first. I don't remember because sometimes they take. How's the line? No, it has to be something like this. I remember knight takes e5, queen takes, bishop b2, queen e5, castle. So this is a position. Maybe black is holding, maybe not, but I don't like playing like this. I mean, white is happy to. If they play bishop b2 and d4, is because they want to play this. Actually, the computer says white is slightly better now, but I don't know. I remember preparing this and it's very risky. So basically, we shouldn't take the pawn right away. Even when it looks like, I mean, you could be considering this queen if I check to be okay. This one is also tricky. And what I do in general is just g6, bishop, castle, then you defend the pawn, and then I keep playing, right? Sometimes I end up playing e5. It will look some sort of an Spanish if you want, because it's like black is usually facing this plan. How, for example, we go g6, castle here, they go bishop check, right? So we go knight e7, rook e1, castle d4, a6, b5, e5. Looks more or less like a Spanish at some point, right? But it's more fighting than the rest. Maybe bishop d7 is the best move here, I don't know. But just to consider these two alternatives before the knight, right? Then what else they can do? They can take with the queen, right? This is, I think it's called the Hungarian variation. Basically after knight c6, they go bishop e5, right? There's also queen e3, which is quite popular nowadays, but I guess you can just develop the pieces more or less normally against that. After bishop b5, have you seen this anti-Sicilian, anti-Nidorf, or no?
I don't know if I've seen this one. Probably not. I think I would probably just go on bishop d7 here or something.
Yeah, bishop d7 is the main move by far. And white has some very aggressive plans in this one. They go castle, they go bishop g5, they castle queenside, sorry, and it's quite risky because when we do this, they usually try to attack even with a 45, even with what they do is usually move the queen, go knight e4, and then start pushing the pawns against our king. I used to play like this. Nowadays, I found something much, much better, in my opinion, which is a6. A6 is, well, basically forcing bishop takes e6. There's no only other move, right? If you do this, I go b5, attacking two things. But, well, they takes, we take. Now, the key plan of this position is we want to play e5, knight e7, knight g6, and then bishop e7, castle. Most of the times we will develop like that. One very important moment is here, right? Because they can start by playing e5, right? And if they play castle, we just go here, knight e7, knight, and everything works more or less fine. But what happens, or what moves do you consider if they go e5? I mean, instead of castle. These are some important moments. There's probably two correct ways, but one is the most critical.
Maybe d5 is one of them.
D5 is one of them, yes.
I don't like taking on e5.
Taking would be really, really bad because they take on d8, they take on e5. We lose castle, we will lose another pawn. Taking is clearly not a good option.
And maybe looking at c5 or bishop b7.
C5, bishop b7.
Yeah, no, like that one, that or that.
Uh huh. Well, between all those options, I really prefer d5. I mean, then you play probably e6 and c5, and it should be fine. But there is something more critical because this one is tricky. I mean, probably this move is okay, but the best move I believe here is f6, which is very strange if you ask me, because usually we don't play a move like this. We really want to play e5. Right, so after e takes, we will play e5. After pawn takes, we probably go knight f6 and then e5. We get the center, we get the two bishops. It's really nice to do this. And after this, we just go e5. They move, and we go queen d6. Ideally, we will try to trade queens and play with the two bishops. Right, we have very nice pawn structure once we trade queens. So. Now, this is some anti-Sicilians that you should know before going into the neither, right? Then the last one I can think now is after knight f6, they can also play f3. So, of course, the neither will start after knight c3, a6, right? But what happens if they go f3? What do you think of this move?
This I'm thinking either e5 or knight c6. But then also the knight can maybe go to b5, so I don't know if a6 will be played at some point, maybe even in this position, and then go for e5 or knight c6.
What do you think White will do if we play, let's say, a normal move here, knight c6, a6, e6? What's the next move for White?
I don't know. I think like at some point they might go G4, but I don't know if they do it this early. I guess they are trying to develop pieces in castle queenside.
Well, the idea of f3 is, I mean, I guess this is played more against dragon players, because usually when you play the dragon, I mean, if you don't know anything concrete about f3, you will play this and you will allow a Maroxi system, right? The Maroxi in general is very annoying to face because they just get the center, play a position like this, for example. It's supposed to be easy to play for white, right? Castle, b3, rook c1, everything is. It's very nice. So f3 is trying to get a Maroxi and c4. And the only move that prevents the Maroxi is playing e5 immediately, right? Like, more or less in the neither of spirit. You know, if we play a6, after, I don't know, half of the moves at least, we will play e5, right? There are some moves that we can't play e5. We will see that. But after f3, if we do a6, c4, we are in trouble already. I mean, not in trouble, but facing an annoying position, and we probably need to play e5 here immediately. And now there's a nice trick I always try to play online. I even remember, I think I won a bullet game against Magnus in this line. He went knight b3, and I go a5, which, if you ask me, I don't believe a5 is a good move, but I do it on purpose on Blitz, because what do you think White alternatives are after a5? What I want to play, or the typical move for white here would be c4, right? And knight c3 and bishop e3, bishop e2, castle, something like that again. When I go a5, what do you think now? Would you play c4 anyway? Would you try to do something else?
Probably A4,
Yeah,
but
a4 is one of the moves. Weakens b4, I weaken b5, so it's more or less balanced. A4 is a decent move. I think a4 is okay. Probably what I don't like is bishop b5 first, and then if I block with the knight, you might go a4, or even knight c3 stopping a4. It's probably good enough. This move is probably just a trap, and the trap is when they play c4 anyway, right? Because imagine in a blitz game, you play f3 here is because you want to play c4. And after e5 here, a5, you might play a4 again because a4 knight e2 is not the end of the world or anything. You just go knight c3 then and keep developing. This pawn is kind of weak. But the idea after c4 is not playing a4. We have a tactic that is very nice. Try to consider some aggressive idea here for black.
Maybe knight takes e4 and then queen h4.
Then what alternatives you see for white?
I can't go g3 because of queen e4, so they have to just move the king, I guess. So if king e2, then there's bishop g4, and so they had to go king d2 instead. And maybe a4, is that trapping the
Exactly.
knight? Yeah.
Exactly. That's the idea. Because if we play like this, immediately king d2 is just fine, right? Actually, maybe even g3 winning four king f2, because now there is bishop b5 check if we take the rook on h1. But I mean, even this move, there's no good continuation, right? But probably this is even simpler in this situation, right? When the check is here. So c4 is blocking the bishop, a4 is avoiding knight e2. Everything works very well, and yeah, I mean, I remember I got this position. It's not so bad for white. I mean, it's of course better for black, but it's not like you win or lose. I mean, we play something like this, he took, and we play this position, and I won a blitz, a bullet against Hans Carlsen, I remember. In League Chess or chess.com, or I mean online in general, there's a lot of people that falls in into this trap, right? What I do on a real or a serious game, I went d5 usually here. I believe this is the best move. And after bishop g5, what it's what they play, I go bishop e6. So the idea is I will go for an endgame. If you play takes takes, I takes takes, I take with the bishop, and then I will play this. It's not like super good, super bad. It's okay. I mean, to play like this, I believe. There is also, yeah, I don't remember. I think I take with the queen first. Now I have some doubts because I can also take with the bishop here, bishop e6. Maybe this is what I was doing. I mean, this castle knight e7. I think this was okay as well. So some endgame like this, but again, it's important that you know the d5 move or this tactic that works well. And the last thing before entering in the knight of a specific case, bishop b5 check here, we have to go knight e7, and now they go knight f5. This is quite tricky if you don't know it. Like, what's your first impression? What we need to do? What is white trying to do?
Take on d6, I think, and so let's see. I'm currently looking at a6 to see if that helps. But my first moves I was looking at were queen b6, or
Queen
maybe
b6.
considering Yeah, probably. Like, I guess something like Queen A5, they could just develop the knight and protect the bishop.
I suppose if we go Queen B6 or Queen A5, the answer is going to be the same. They just go knight C3 defending. If the queen is on A5, they are still attacking this pawn. If we go Queen B6, they can go Bishop E3. So here we have mainly two moves. One is A6, as you mentioned, and it's probably completely playable, I would say. They will take the knight. We will take with the queen, I suppose, to avoid knight d6. And now they should try to play around this d5 square, which is weak. How? I don't know. Bishop c4 to take it. c4, knight e3. I'm more related to d5. So this is very concrete. And here I play d5 first because I don't want to be like blocked on this square. And I want to develop my bishop, and even if I have to sacrifice a pawn, this is very, very interesting. And now the main line is e takes, and now we go a6. So what happens now? If they take, we take with the bishop now, we don't have to take with the queen. They move the knight, and we go bishop c5. And this position is very, very aggressive for black, very good. We will do this, probably queen b6, maybe e4. Another plan is knight h5, threatening queen h4 and even f5 f4, right? Imagine, for example, a mating pattern that will happen in this line is when they castle, we will move the knight and go f5 f4. So usually they will go king h1, right, to leave this diagonal. And then what's our idea? Well, at some point, play knight g3, pawn takes, and mate, I don't know, with queen h5, queen h6. This mating net, I know if you follow more or less the idea, would be great. Imagine, I don't know, to make it very concrete. Probably we should play a bit different, but we can try to do this like immediately. Here we go f4, and if they move the knight, I don't know, maybe knight g3 here is already winning with takes and queen, even pawn takes maybe wins to play queen h4. So this idea is very typical for this line, and it's very interesting to make this pawn sacrifice. So after a6, they go bishop a4. And now, well, you can take a look then at the engine, at the most popular move, and so on. What they do is b5, bishop b3, and knight c5, I think. But I found with the computer that the best move here is a5. It's not very popular. I mean, we want to trap the bishop, of course. But also, when they play d6, we want to play a4, forcing the bishop to d5 and then rook a6. And we will recover this pawn with a very, very strong attack. So, okay, this is more or less all the anti-Nidorf, right? Before talking about the Nidorf, I wanted to show you these alternatives. This is super superficial, let's say. I mean, there's a lot of things you should know, but more or less this will be a good guide. I will send you a database that will have everything, and they, as far as I remember, Git is recommending more or less all these lines I'm telling you. Maybe some slightly difference, but in general, this is the anti-Sicilian stuff. Then we have the Nidorf, right? I don't know if you study something already, if you saw some games or how the idea of playing the Nidorf appear, let's say. But what do you know about this position? What lines are the most critical for black? Is there any line that you don't like to face or something like this?
I remember stuff like Bishop G5 or F4 and just castling queenside, but I didn't really study like through any books or anything. I just kind of looked through like Bobby Fischer's games. I was just trying to copy what he did. So I don't
Well,
really know much about.
Fischer used to play the Nadal a lot. Also Kasparov. I mean, it's like all the world champions at some point, especially Kasparov and Fischer, but some others as well. And well, Fischer as white used to play Bishop C4. I suppose you know the so seeing Fischer attack. I mean, it has his name. There's an important thing to say here. I suppose when someone plays the Nidorf is to play with e5 in general, right? The idea is to play e5 in all the positions we can, right? For example, after bishop e2, we can play both e6, trying to play Scheveningen, and we can play e5, trying to play more in Nidorf style. The way I play it is every time I can, I play e5. I mean, it's more or less like that. I don't like playing the Scheveningen. This is a line that you could also play with e6 immediately, but it has one theoretical problem that the Keres attack with g4 is very annoying. I mean, it's very fast for white. They will probably don't even castle. I mean, they just go for g5, push this pawn, rook g1, g6. Sometimes they don't even develop a single piece and they are attacking, and it's very annoying. So I think people don't play e6 because of this. And some people go here because after bishop e2, we can go e6, and now g4 makes no sense if we add these two moves. Like we will have b5 faster, the bishop on f1, or d1 is more or less the same to play g4, right? Because usually you go here, but on e2 is like more or less a waste of tempo. But what I wanted to tell you today, for a first time talking about the Nidorf, is we should try to play e5 against most of the moves, but there's two moves. Let me think. Well, two of the main moves, probably after queen f3, for example. We also don't want to play e5, but the queen f3 is no one plays it. But about the main moves, it's bishop g5 and bishop c4. These two moves has some problem if we want to play e5, let's say. What's the problem? And that these two moves fight for the d5 square immediately. Why? Because bishop g5, e5, for example, we can always take the knight to bring knight d5, right? And if we go bishop c4, I mean, we can go knight f5 in this position because of that. Because here, if we could play d5, this would be great, but there's knight f6, knight d5. The same happens with bishop c4. We can't react with bishop takes on d5, right? Because again, white has so many pieces. They are not taking on g5, but still they cover d5. So, how can I? Okay. I wanted to promote a6. Here it is. So, basically, after these two moves, that the reason is because of that, right? For example, if they go h3 and we want to play e5 after this, we probably can take, or we can probably go d5 immediately, right? There's no problem, especially playing d5. This is usually undermining the knight. Attacking e4, trying to play d4, this is usually a good answer. But bishop c4 and bishop g5 are the two moves that we have to play e6. To say the, to make it simple, right? All the rest, what's all the rest? A3, A4, F3, Bishop E3, G3, H3, H4, Rook G1. I mean, there's a lot of attempts to face the Nidorf. F4 as well. There's, you can see in some opening tree or something that white tried almost everything here. There's knight b3. There's actually knight b3 is one of the moves that probably we don't want to play e5. What do you think knight b3 e5 could be? Why this could be a problem for black from a positional point of view, right? We are not blundering anything, but since we are not attacking the knight, there are some problems. What do you think the next move for white It's gonna be after e5.
Maybe bishop g5, because then the queen's also guarding, was also attacking e5, so it's somewhere different before where the bishop tried to take the knight.
Yeah,
Or
exactly. Basically, bishop g5 is a problem here because we can't play d5. And also, white is kind of threat. This, when I say threatening, it's not again like we lose as black. But if they go bishop f6, we take with the queen, and they go knight d5, winning tempo. We have to move the queen back, and then they just keep a piece on d5, and we are not fighting for this square. Then we have a positional problem, right? So I guess all the rest, which is bishop e2, bishop d3, h3, h4, g3, rook g1. We just go e5, and usually we continue bishop e7, bishop e6, castle knight e7. If we have to put like a general setup, right? Like this is what we most of the times do. There are some specific cases where we can't because we need to play something else. But in general, we will be happy playing. Let's suppose white is just losing tempos, right? But we would like to have a setup more or less like this, right? Usually we will try to continue with b5. Sometimes white will avoid it with a4. Sometimes, of course, I just waste like 10 tempos for white. This won't happen, right? But if we have a position like this with castle, king h1, f3, something like that, maybe f3 not, because I want to tell you this. If we can sack an exchange here to take this pawn, this is going to be a pattern that most of the time is going to be okay. I mean, there, you don't have to see any way to recover the exchange. Just destroying the pawn structure plus taking e4, it's going to be good, right? This is a pattern that it's like knowledge. I mean, we don't have to see anything concrete here. This is usually good. There is a famous game of Kasparov, actually, that, let me see if I can copy you that game, because it shows more or less this with castle queenside. It's even worse. So I think it's against Movsesyan. Yeah. How do I copy the PGN? Okay, I think I saw here. You're recording, right? Because I was thinking that when I copy the PGN, you will lose
Yeah,
the.
that won't be a problem. Like, I'll just rewatch and like recreate the stuff.
So maybe, I don't know, maybe I just send
Unless,
you the link of
wait, I
the
can
game.
actually download this one. So yeah, I just
Ah,
download
okay.
this one. So yeah, you just
Perfect,
let me know
perfect.
when to save it, and I can do that.
Perfect, perfect. Then, did you download already?
Yeah, I'm ready for you could erase this one and put that one up.
Okay. So the next one is gonna be this. This is a really famous game of Kasparov. This example is with e6, right? In a position that I would play with e5, but anyway, it's very interesting. After bishop e3, I like playing e5, and bishop e6, and knight e7, and bishop e7. But he went e6. And I'm copying you this only to show you that rook takes e3 is usually a good move, even if you don't take anything. Like if you all you need to do is to double pawns, right? If the queen is on d2, no, don't go rook c3. If there is a queen or a knight defending, of course you won't take it. But this line, he goes knight fd7 to defend the knight, avoid tactics. He goes rook c8, and now very big mistake by white. Probably already played wrong the opening, but he should try to defend this. Like knight c2, for example, would be a better move than bishop d3. And now Kasparov goes rook c3. This type of move, if you would play the Sicilian and especially the Nidorf, it's something you have to be ready to play. I mean, because after pawn takes, we just continue knight a4, queen c7. And it's not like we are winning immediately. I repeat this. This is not a tactical sacrifice, right? This is just positional and long term. We go queen c7, knight a4, bishop e7, castle, bring the rook. And eventually our pieces will be attacking the king, and the pawn structure is just too bad. So the game then is very, very good. White is very slow attacking, right? Because you need to push so many moves that maybe when you go g6, I ignore you, and when you take, I go here, and when you do this, I go g6, and I more or less hold. This is what happens more or less. And I remember that the final tactic was very nice. Here he goes bishop takes e4. The idea is that if you take bishop e5, why you can't go something like knight d4, for example. He went g6, but why not d takes e4?
We say why not D takes E4.
Yeah, why he didn't take the bishop, basically.
Well, taking you go like Bishop E5 though, right?
What's the continuation then? I was thinking something like pawn takes, bishop e5, knight d4.
I'm trying to see if Queen takes C1 does anything, cause then the rook wouldn't be defending the knight, and then after Bishop takes D4.
Takes
Probably
e4.
nothing because they could go like the king could go to b1. Or you take the knight and then after rook takes d4, then you can think do queen takes c1,
Queen takes
and
c1,
that's
exactly. That's the point, right? That it's mate. It's actually a nice mate only with the rook and the knight. So well, that's the line, right? This you can take because of queen c1 and rook c1 mate, and here queen c2 is mate. So he goes g6, but then, I mean, there's probably more than one way to win. He just took the rook, something like this, and he's just mating. Okay, actually, also nice because if you take the queen, bishop c3 is mate. If you take and take, bishop c3 also wins. So now this is just an example of when rook c3 is good. I mean, I also had a game where I did even more positional. Can you download this one so I copy a new one?
Okay, I got it.
So this is my game, and my opponent went h3, right? One of the most critical lines after bishop g5, I suppose. If I have to tell you which lines I'm a bit scared to face in some way, it's usually bishop g5, the number one for sure, because it's very concrete. You have to know exactly what to do. Then the English attack is also very good, and h3. I believe these three options are the best for white. So this one went a6, and now I went e6. I had something in mind. I mean, sometimes I go e5, but this one I wanted to do this, and g4, h6. So I will try to play e5 at some point, right? Trying to get the knight of setup. But here I had this idea in mind, and now I think queen e2 is a mistake. I think f4 is the right m move for white. He went this, and now I took when e5 and bishop e6, right? Same setup always. I believe b5 is better for a very specific reason that we want to play b4 very quickly. And after knight e5, if we take and he has to take with the pawn, this is usually a big, big thing for us. And it's, I would say it's always good for black. When we force e takes e5, why? This is a game I copy before knight e5. This taking with the rook is even worse because now a2 will suffer, right? It's not like b3 will trap the bishop when we have queen a5 as well in a position like this. We don't have to take with the bishop. Queen a5 just wins this pawn. But if they take with the pawn, first of all, these two pieces are really blocking here. We can start with bishop h4 whenever we want, then play f5, then even push these pawns. If we block this part of the board like this, and then we start pushing, well, we have the initiative, we have the attack. It's a nice position. I think bishop e6 wasn't very good. Then I play some game with b5. Also, this is important, right? This game I won a very nice game, but when I analyze the game, I realize, okay, bishop e6 is not the best. You don't have to feel, okay, I won the game, I did everything right. No, sometimes when I prepare against other players, I try to see the games they win more than the game they lose, right? Because if they lost the game, they will for sure have some improvement to avoid losing again, right? Sometimes when they win, they don't analyze with the same objective evaluation, let's say, right? They won, so, well, okay, maybe B5 is slightly better, but I won with this move. It shouldn't be the attitude, right? Like when I see this, even if I win, I can't repeat this move if B5 is better, right? So after this, he should play castle, rook c8, knight e5. What's the difference now? That when I take with the knight and I move the bishop, I'm losing tempos, and he can immediately start attacking with f4, bishop e4. This tempo I'm losing with the bishop, I don't play b5 before. The rook on c8 is not very useful. Maybe it's better to have the rook here and the pawn on b4 in a very similar situation like we saw before. But he went castle this way, kingside. And definitely a mistake. I go rook c8, threatening the move bishop c4. He needs to play rook fd1, which is a bit annoying for him because it would be better to keep a rook on f1 for him, trying to play f4. So I went castle. This is more or less the setup I always try to get, right? The two bishops here, the rook on c8, castle. Now I did a6 to avoid g5, and that's it. I need to control the d5 square. If he plays g5, I have to move the knight, supposing the pawn is on a7, right? I move the knight, he goes knight e5, and then he can take with the rook. That's something I don't want to see. I mean, I want him to take with the pawn to be okay. So then I went queen a5, b5, he goes queen d1, rook e8. This is a waiting move. Maybe I want to go bishop f8. The rook is defending this pawn eventually to play d5. Of course, right now, I can't. And after king h1, I decide to play rook takes c3. So here, I'm not doing it for a queenside attack, like as part of game. I just do it for positional purpose, right? I win a pawn, and his pawn structure is very weak now. Like, these pawns are not very safe. What I wanted to do in this game, I remember, was attacking e4 with queen c4, for example. And when he plays f3, to play d5. So if he takes, imagine this move, and I go this, and he plays f3, and I go d5. Right, I'm attacking the pawn, and if he takes, I take with the knight. Coming here, here, bishop c5. Oh. Bishop here, too many weaknesses. And the bishop on g2 is definitely really, really bad. So now you have to understand the dynamics of this position, right? We have an exchange down, yes, but clearly these three minor pieces are better than, let's say, even these three, right? I'm not even counting the A1 rook, which is probably worse than D2. But my minor pieces are very, very nice. And actually, he goes rook takes D6 pretty quickly here. And I think it was a good decision. Like here, he goes rook B1, I go queen C4, attacking the pawn. The idea is F3, D5. And now, instead of playing F3, D5, that I think it's probably losing for him, I mean, this is just really bad, he decides to play rook D6, showing, like, I mean, he understood what was happening. This is clearly the right decision. I take E4. I don't even take D6 yet. Because if I do this and I do this, he can play queen takes B4. And I think it's okay for him. When I go queen knight E4, he's still in some trouble. I'm threatening knight C3. I'm threatening the rook. After this, I went queen C7. And now he gave the rook on E6. Why? Because he's losing the exchange anyway. So at least he wants to destroy my pawn structure, right? But still, this is very nice for me. I mean, my knight's coming to C3. I'm attacking C2. This is defended. And after queen bishop B6, I don't know if queen B6 is the best move. I remember it was nice to play it because I saw the endgame was very annoying for him. Maybe it's a wrong decision. Seems like I can play queen C2 here. But anyway, I took, and went for this endgame, where I have two pawns. Yeah, it's double pawns and it's opposite color bishop. But I believe I can always play e4, bring the king to e5, and try to convert this, covering a lot of squares with my pawns, right? So I don't know. The rest doesn't matter too much, but I got the position I wanted, and I end up winning. Like, more or less normal game, right? Rook F1 and E1 in the end. So some examples in the neither. Last position I want to show you to make you understand a bit the structure and the ideas is, if you want to download, do it. So you have to.
I got it.
To see you again. Okay. And the last game is this one, where my opponent goes bishop e2. This is a move that I always, always reacted with e5. And now the main move is knight b3. But recently there's like there's some games of Carlsen that he went bishop e2 and knight f3. The idea of knight f3 is basically going bishop g5, taking, going knight e4, right? And then trying to play bishop c4, keep a piece on d5. I played as white some games bishop e3, e5, knight f3 to do this, and then take this. It's like always we have to move a bishop again. It's not ideal in both cases, because here we need to do this again. And in this line, we have to play bishop c4 again. But still, since the position is not concrete, not tactical, this tempo we will end up losing in some way, it's not too relevant. There are some ideas with a4, trying to combine these two things and using the tempos better, right? Because here we go knight f3, and now the bishop won't have to move twice, I mean. And a4 is quite useful because we stop b5. But, well, this line I decided to play knight bd7. I think this is an interesting approach, because if I go bishop e6, the idea is takes knight e5, right? What we don't want to face is endgames like this, where white takes with pieces, and this bishop is going to be a disaster, right? Eventually, he puts a bishop on d5 or a knight like this, I don't know, knight e2, knight f1, knight e3. It's the most typical way to go. When they put a knight on d5, we are in big trouble. Even in opposite color bishop endgames. Imagine this knight comes to d5. Then we play knight c6, knight e7, and we trade. And they take with a queen. And we only get queen and bishop versus queen and bishop. This endgame is also really bad for black, if they take with queen here. So I go knight e7 with the idea of, if he takes, I take with a knight, I fight for d5. basically, right? If he goes knight e5, I will take bishop e6. I don't have to allow him to keep the pieces blocking me on d5. So after this, I go a6. The same, right? If he takes and he goes knight e5, I will do this, and eventually bishop e6. I don't know, queen, and then bishop e6. If he plays bishop c4, I will go bishop e6, right? I will never allow him to play knight e5 so easily. So he went bishop e3. I went knight g4, he goes bishop c1, I went back, and now he goes bishop e3 again, saying something like, okay, I don't mind repeating. If you want, we make a draw, but well, I wanted to play, of course. Here I have, I think, like 200 points. He's a FIDE master, but I still need to try to play more. I went queen c7, which is normal move. He goes knight e2. Now I go knight c5, attacking the pawn, so he can't go knight c4. And now he should play bishop c3, bishop f3. I mean, defending the pawn, then castling, and then maneuvering. But he plays the move bishop takes c5, which is a big, big, big mistake, because this is the good bishop in some way for him. This is usually blocked by the pawns. There's no good square except this diagonal, which makes more sense to have the bishop. Like, if you have in some of this square, would be nice. But after this, he goes knight c4, trying to play knight e3, bishop c4, and use this square. But the problem now is I'm too active. I mean, I went bishop e6, attacking the knight. He goes knight e3. And now, not very typical move in the knight order, but I go bishop d8. Because usually I don't have the queen on c5 in the knight order. I can't just do this in two moves. There's always the queen blocking on d8 or c7. But here I can go bishop d8, and now basically I force him to play knight e5 immediately. All right? And here, well, I can even do some other things. But when I saw this, it's what I was telling you. If I can force him to take with the e-pawn in the end, even if it's opposite color bishop, I should be very happy. Like, I went for this because he takes with the pawn. Now, the queen side is more or less blocked, but he can't, especially since a4 is here, he's not very flexible to play a3 before c5, right? The pawn here is not very good. I would try to, I mean, eventually block him. Like, if I can get a position like this, it's more or less winning for me because his extra pawn is not doing anything and my pawn is gonna be a pass pawn, right? So he went b4 here. This was a miscalculation. He thought he could do this, a5, c3, and take on b7, but I just go king e7, king f6. I think he just missed rook check. I just go here, and I'm okay. And then it's just an extra pawn. And well, I won more or less a good game, but doesn't matter too much. I just want to show you that an endgame like this, where I force him to take with a pawn, it's very, very annoying for him. And this happens in most of the structures in the knight. If they play e takes like this, and I can start pushing my 4 versus 3, right? It's going to be very, very pleasant for black. I have some other model games I will send you in the database. So take a look at that.
Okay.
What to remember here? Bishop c4, bishop g5, and knight b3, which is not very popular. You shouldn't play e5 because you are not covering d5. Or actually, white is doing something to fight for the d5 square. And then in the first part, we saw like all the alternatives that white can do. I mean, not all, actually, because as I told you, there is Alapin, there is Mora, there is a lot of anti-Sicilians that are not very serious. But knight f3, bishop b5 is very interesting. I recommend you knight e7. c3, I think, is very interesting. d4 and taking with the queen is very interesting. And playing f3 here is also very interesting. All these approaches are what white is trying to do to avoid an either. There's a lot of anti-NIDLF there, but I suppose, I don't know, what's the, I would say more than 50% of the time you should get to the NIDLF against players that know theory, right? There will be a lot of cases where, I don't know, your opponent goes this and this and this because they played Italian and they want to play the same against the Sicilian. Of course, you put a pawn on e6 and this is just bad. I mean, you can play bishop c4 in the Italian because the pawn is already on e5. Some players will do this. You should be happy to win some tempo with e6, e5, and that's it. But against players that know the theory, I would expect at least 50% of the players entering in the NIDLF, maybe even more. But there's a lot of players that will avoid by picking some sideline, which could be bishop b5 check, especially, right? This is the most frequent anti-NIDLF you will see. Okay, I think I will send you some things on Skype, and okay. Let me know if we go back to usual time next, in 2 weeks or something, but if we go to Monday or
yeah, we'll see. Sunday, because so far, is Sunday like a, if Sunday's a good day that you can make. We might actually have to switch to that if I get the new job, because I'd be working on Mondays. But
okay.
So yes, yeah, so we might actually switch to Sunday. If that's not
Sunday
too big
works
of a problem.
As well. Maybe. What I actually there's this time, I usually have a lesson every 2 weeks with someone else. So okay. If we find a way that I do 1 week with you. And what 1 week with him, that would work perfect if you like this time specific. I don't know.
But also, I could try to find like a different time that works for you to keep it consistent with every week if I end up doing like every week a lesson.
Okay.
Too.
Yes. If we will do every week, it should be a different time for sure. Could be, yes, something earlier, like 1 hour earlier probably works always. But well, then we probably can talk about that in Skype.
Yeah.
Then we confirm. But yeah, probably Sunday will work. If Monday you will be working, we can move to Sunday.
Okay.
Okay, I will send you a few things in a few hours. Please check Skype. Okay.
All right, no problem.
Okay, that's it for today. And well. See you next week, maybe. We will see. We talk in Skype, okay?
Yeah, I'll keep you updated. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Bye-bye, Jeff.
Bye.
See you.